A little earlier, welcome to the Good Morning Couch, Steve Abel. Hi,
hey,
Steve.
How's it going?
To have you
good
here.
To see you. Yeah, yeah.
That description I said earlier, which was what, folk, rock, gothic.
Yeah, yeah.
Music writers seem to love those kind of things. How do you describe your music?
Oh, I do find it hard.
Yeah.
I mean, it's nice when you get a critic or a writer come up with a term, you think, oh, that's nice. I kind of, oh, you know,
I'll use that.
I'll take that. You know?
Yeah. It really reminded me of the band, that fantastic American band in the 70s. Who did you listen to? Who were your influences on your music?
I think it's fascinating what you listen to, because I listen to a huge amount of stuff, and like any kid in their teens, I was a fan of the Hit Parade and all the top 20. And then as you get older, you discover the deeper history of things and the whole pantheon of rock, if you like. And what's more interesting than what you listen to is what you're moved by, and you end up sort of manifesting, I think, in a way. And so it comes down to what you love, you know. And I loved songs. I loved good songs. I didn't really care what the genre was, and so that's really what I'm into still, you know.
That voice is breathtaking, and I do agree. Cool. When someone said like Shane McGowan, it sort of has that sort of lived-in feel as well. Has it always been like that?
I don't know. I think I sort of realized at some point after my voice had broken that I had a deeper voice than other people, and I hadn't necessarily known that, you know.
Oh, right. But that's deep.
And then you've just got to go with what you've got,
right.
You know. I mean, I love people who can sing really high and beautiful as well, you know. If I had that voice, I'd sing with it.
Let's talk about Flax Happy. This is your sophomore album, as everyone says.
Yeah.
Were you happy with it?
Which means second.
Yeah,
it's
second
a flash
album,
word for second.
Of course, yeah.
we're really proud of it, yeah, because we record it in 2 days live at Roundhead Studios, so it's a very live sort of album.
That's what I found interesting, because, you know, most albums, it seems like they take 50 years and it's take after take after take, but you really wanted that sort of live feel to it, didn't you?
Yeah. Well, I mean, there's a couple of factors there, but the band, we play together live, and that's when we're at our best, and so the guys all set up in the main studio, and we just did take after take, and moved from song to song. And we thought we'd get 8 songs. We ended up getting 13 songs in 2 days, and that was just great. Yeah.
And you had Anika Moa come in as well.
Yeah, Anika, we did it. She sung on a song that was written by a guy, or part of the lyric that I used was by a guy called Parare Tomawana, who wrote Pakarikariana.
Right.
Yeah. And I spoke to his granddaughter to get permission to use the lyric. Yeah, Ngāti Huata. Yeah,
that's
a lovely woman. Yeah, she's cool.
But that's also keeping her grandfather's music alive.
Yeah, well, actually, the most amazing thing was she described our version of the song, or our song where we used his lyric, because it's actually our own melody and stuff. It's not his actual song.
All right.
But I used part of his lyric. She described it as hauntingly poignant, so that was the greatest sort of compliment. And she felt I could hear talking to her on the phone, the incredible connection she had to her grandfather's words, you know, his lyrics. And that was an amazing kind of connection.
Yeah.
Because I just thought, wow, because the lyrics of a song can, you know, they live long beyond the writer, you know. And they have meaning for other people and other generations. And so that was a really nice connection to make. Yeah.
Your band is made up of some of New Zealand's most high-profile and successful musicians.
Yeah, yeah.
I was really blown away when I saw who was coming in today.
Yeah.
How did you get them to play with you?
I just bribed them.
No, yeah. Seriously, how?
Well, I mean, I've sort of known most of them for a long time, and we originally assembled to record the first album. We didn't necessarily know we were going to stay together as a band, but we have, because we enjoy it so much. And yeah, but it's a total privilege to play with such great musicians. Yeah.
The other interesting thing I like Milan and Geoff, you know, and Mike, they were smiling. They were like on stage, like woohoo.
Yeah.
I guess it must be fun for them to sort of just get in and make music, and it's not all the pressure as well.
Oh, I think so. Yeah. You probably have to ask them, but I think they do enjoy that. Yeah, just being players, but they write all their parts, and they sing all the harmonies, and they come up with the stuff. So it's totally a collective effort, you know.
So they should. They are hugely talented.
Well, they are.
Yeah.
They are hugely talented, yeah.
But
I feel very lucky.
The first time I met you, though, was years ago, and you were working for Greenpeace, weren't you?
Yeah.
So what happened? You sort of had a huge change in life.
It's not so much a huge change. I mean, in many ways, I've always been a musician.
Right.
But I hadn't necessarily had that as my main focus.
Yeah.
And I reached a point where I decided that I was ready to do more music, you know, to make that more of a focus. And that's a natural transition in many ways, you know.
Right.
It wasn't, in my mind and heart, it wasn't a huge change, but I suppose externally it looks like a big change.
Totally.
You know? Greenpeace is a lot of hard work, it's long hours, and I think I needed to do something else for a while, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
You're moving to Switzerland on Monday.
Yeah.
As you do.
As you do, yeah, yeah.
Are you, like, ready for that? Are you going to be making music over there as well? What's going
to
happen?
That's the plan, yeah, right. To go and make music, yeah. But, I mean, I really... I've been in Europe. I've lived in London for a couple of years, but I've never been to Switzerland, so...
Why are you going? What's the...
My partner has a job there, so... Yeah, it's sort of an opportunity that's arisen out of that, and it's incredibly exciting, you know.
So. That's, well, some men would be like, I'm going with my partner, but you've got no worries, have you?
No, well, she's got a sort of a vocational path, yeah. You know. She's got things she wants to be doing, and right. You take it as a partnership, don't you?
Well, some people don't. So good on you. I have to say, you really like the music as well.
Oh, thank you, man.
Hopefully you'll be back soon and doing more gigs because you get your last one tonight.
We'll come back in the summer, definitely. Excellent. We're looking at February, so. But our last one in Wellington tonight.
Yeah.
At Mighty Mighty.
Excellent. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you, Stephen.
Now, yeah, as he just said, Steve's last New Zealand gig is tonight in Wellington at Mighty Mighty with Samuel Flynn Scott at 8 o'clock. I don't think you want to miss it. And we have 5 copies of Steve's new album, Flax, happy to give away. Just tell us which country Steve is moving to. You can enter online at tvnz.co.nz, the keyword good morning, and follow the links into our competition area. Or you can send your answer to Good Morning Steve Abel Giveaway, PO Box 31643, Lower Hutt. And we'll have another song from Steve and his band later in the show.